Welcome to the Libertarian Counterpoint. I'm Richard Fields. On the program, Erik Andresen, who heads up the operations of a libertarian nonprofit in the Sacramento area. Also, John Cameron, the head of the effectiveleadershipcoach.com. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Richard.
Thank you for being here. We're also, in addition to being on television, on the internet at www.accesssacramento.org. And if you don't catch the show live or catch it in the middle of the show or something like that, you can pick up reruns at noon on Friday or 4 a.m. on Saturday, the live show 8 p.m. on Thursday. We appreciate the fact that you're paying attention. Release of 40,000 felons is something that's being hung out there as a cost-cutting measure for the state of California, and of course the Republicans are going crazy over it. They're saying this is awful. I am a recipient of an email letter from Bill Leonard, the Republican. I think he's insurance commissioner or board of equalization, something like that. Anyway, he's one of the few statewide Republican office holders. He sends out an email, and he questioned the idea that releasing 40,000 felons is a good idea as a cost-cutting measure. But in his own email, he said that there are 31,000. And I'm not questioning his numbers. I'm assuming his numbers are correct. He said there are 31,000 people in prison in the state of California on drug crimes, which are victimless crimes, or at least the only victim are the drug users themselves and perhaps their families. There are 6,400 people who are in prison on gun law violations. Mm-hmm. Now, to be fair, some of these gun law violations are probably felons carrying firearms in a violation of their parole. But I would argue that if you are a paroled criminal or a paroled ex-criminal, let's say, being released back to the old hood, you probably have a greater need of self-defense than most other people do, and to take away the right to own a gun from that class of society is at best counterproductive and probably could be lethal for the people who don't get to carry guns for their own self-protection. That adds up to 37,400. We're only 2,600 away from the 40,000 people being released. And as I remember from a few years ago, there was a thing called three strikes that was passed, the result of which is that people who are picked up for a misdemeanor third strike, something like shoplifting or swapping a pizza off of somebody else's plate was one example that I came across. These people are being put into jail for life. It was 30 years or life, I forget, for a very long extended period of time. So it seems to me that coming up with 40,000 people to parole is child's play. And if we simply get rid of the drug laws that cause most of this crime indirectly in the first place, we're three steps ahead of the game. What's the problem? What's the problem with my thinking?
Well, you're wrong. That's what's the problem with your thinking. You're just wrong. Yeah, drugs are evil. They're just evil. I mean, there is a radical difference between a fifth of good whiskey and a joint. A fifth of good whiskey will make you beat your wife and wreck a car, and a joint will make you sit in your house and raid the refrigerator. Don't you see that joint is evil?
And eat Twinkies, yes.
Eat Twinkies. And you might have to buy bigger clothes. That's the evil of it. You don't see it?
Yeah. No, I don't see it either.
I don't see it either. Yeah. I think what the evil is the whole system. They talked about the military-industrial complex with Eisenhower warned about it, and he was an ex-general. In this case, we have the quote-unquote correctional
medical
officers,
law enforcement correctional officers,
and they need prisoners in order to keep their
prisons open.
And that's what generates
and the
their
guards
jobs.
Making $100,000 pensions.
And
after
so,
23
in,
years
in
or
order
like
to fill the prisons, they have to arrest people who use drugs and put them in prisons. And then, if you'll ask any warden in the country, they will tell you that 98% to 92%, depending upon the study, of the drugs that enter prisons come in from?
The guards. Where else? They don't fly in
They don't
through
fly
the
in,
bars.
And the ability for a prisoner to, I'm going to use a different word here, carry a significant amount of drugs into prison is rather small, and they put them in something called a dry room. And I won't go into detail about it for a while on the way in. So virtually none of it comes through the prisoners, none of it comes through conjugal visits. So you have people being put in prison for a victimless crime. And then you have the people who are supposed to be correcting them. I don't know where that name came from. Selling them the same drugs that they were using on the streets. So change the drug laws, let these people go free. And you talk about a disenfranchised group of non-voters, look at felons. People are let out, they've served their time, and they can't
paid
get
their debt to society.
Paid their debt to society.
But they can't
can
vote.
They get certain jobs? No.
Can't
can they vote?
Vote?
No. Can they do many of the things that are indeed rights according to our Constitution? No. So
now,
this is lunacy.
I need to point out, when I got this email, I responded using essentially the same arguments that I've made this evening to Bill Leonard. And to his credit, he responded. He answered my email. He actually read it. He wrote an email back and said, well, you're 2,600 short. I told him where that 2,600 would come from, but he ignored that. And then I turned around and invited him to come on this show.
Mm-hmm.
And I would like to make that invite public. Mm-hmm. Bill Leonard, you are invited to come on this show and talk about this issue, plus many issues that we agree on.
When he comes, can I come too?
Many issues upon which we are in total agreement. I mean, I think he's probably one of the sharper Republicans in the state.
Mm-hmm.
But on this issue, like all Republicans, or like most Republicans, he doesn't know what the heck he's talking about.
Well,
we have a problem with Republicans sticking their head in the sands when it comes to the efficacy of victimless crime laws.
I would tend to agree with you there, because I think that the average Californian would not agree with the idea of putting a misdemeanant in prison for 25 years to life just based upon their prior records. A misdemeanor typically served in the county jail.
Third strike, that passed by referendum, did it not?
I do not remember.
It did, but I recall, and maybe you gentlemen do as well, that it was after the fact that we really saw some of the consequences of three strikes.
Yeah.
It was kind of sold to us that this is going to put violent offenders away and they're never going to come out again. But then we have, how many stories have we heard of somebody who was a shoplifter or somebody, whatever the minor charge might be, that then ended up having to serve 25 to life just based upon his or her prior criminal record?
Right. One half of the New York City metro area auto dealers have said they're pulling out of the Cash for Clunkers program. Why would they be pulling out of this Cash for Clunkers program, which is where the government gives them money for dumping acid in the car and making it not run anymore? Well, they're not actually getting the money. This is the only stimulus program that the Obama administration has done that actually, in the short run at least, stimulates consumer spending at the local level. It's actually, helped the auto industry in the short run.
As long as you're not selling used cars.
In the short run, it's helped sell new cars.
It's helped to sell new cars
in the
short run.
In the short run.
And there's a problem with it. And
all kinds of
problems
with it. But the biggest problem is that they can't even give away money efficiently. I mean, we have a stimulus program where they're supposed to be giving away money to auto dealers and indirectly to the auto companies. They can't even give away, but they can't even write checks. Now, they write checks to welfare recipients. That seems to work okay. They write checks to people getting their Social Security. Maybe we need to get a direct deposit to the auto dealers. Maybe that'll make it work.
Well, it's business.
Their core competency, remember, is collecting money from people. Not
when we have 185% of the budget being funded by borrowing money as opposed to taxation.
Good at that too.
I would say that their core competency has some holes in it as well. Although I hesitate to say that, because I'm sure that will simply encourage the IRS and the Treasury Department and the tax raisers in Congress to work all the harder.
I've heard two great, and I think it's wonderful that the not wonderful. You see a business owner that is trying to, take in the business that is being offered. And like you said, it was one of the few that actually did stimulate some consumer spending out there, however misguided and short term it might be. But I look at it and I say that's what happens when you get into bed with the government. It's you at they're in control. You can't beat them. You can't win. The two best analyses that I heard of this was one was from Peter Schiff, who pointed out the lunacy of giving a financial incentive to an individual at a point when Americans are finally saving money again. We finally have a real savings rate that we can speak of. It's not very big.
5%.
But it's there. Yeah. And hopefully it's going to continue.
Not negative anymore.
Exactly. And now you've given them an incentive to go out and acquire new debt by destroying a perfectly operable car. Yeah. Whether or not it gets good gas mileage is not really the question. And then the other one was from the libertarian writer Vox Day, who's kind of a persona non grata among certain libertarian groups, but he pointed out that essentially what you're doing is you are consuming tomorrow's demand today.
Yeah, obviously. And they're just borrowing car sales from the future because absolutely. A certain percentage of the people who participate as buyers in the Cash for Clunkers program were going to buy a new car anyway because it was time.
Right.
So they're just getting free money. And the people who are buying sooner than they would have otherwise won't buy later. So in the long run, it's a zero-sum game. It's actually a negative-sum game.
Hmm. And so who's being hurt by it?
The people who are being hurt by it are obviously the people who would happily buy those clunkers for basic transportation, mm-hmm. whether it's in this country or in third world countries or wherever, who need wheels to get to work, who need wheels to, to do what they need to do, go look for jobs, whatever.
Who else?
Now they can't.
Anybody, auto wreckers, auto dismantlers, people who are trying to refurbish or rebuild a car, used car dealers. So I would argue that even though there was a slight economic stimulus, which wasn't actually a stimulus, as you pointed out, it simply shifted demand a little bit and paid some people who would have bought anyway.
Yeah, it's a modern day example of the broken window theory, the Boston Gap broken window parable. If a window is broken, hey, it makes jobs for the glazier. It makes jobs for the people who the glazier hires. It makes job for the baker who the glazier spends money buying bread from. The problem is you don't see the opportunities that money would have been spent on elsewhere. If the glazier, if you didn't have to pay the glazier to fix the broken window, you'd spend that money on buying a new car or a new, more bread or whatever.
Or a $4,500 clunker.
Exactly. The other thing, of course, about the whole cash for clunkers thing is that it's money that's gone down. It's perfectly workable machinery that's simply gone. It's wasted. It's a net loss to society. The only possible
you can buy a darn good used car for $4,500 if you know how to negotiate.
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. The only possible benefit is that it removes carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and we won't even get into that whole issue unless you really want to, John.
Well, not do we have an hour and a half added to the show?
Since the start of this depression, and I call it a depression, not a recession. Oh, by the way, you mentioned Peter Schiff,
mm-hmm.
and I wanted to make an announcement. Peter Schiff, of course, is running for Congress against Chris Dodd, or he's doing an exploratory campaign running for Senate against Chris Dodd in Connecticut. And also, Rand Paul, who is Ron Paul's son, is running for Senate for the Jim Bunning seat. Jim Bunning has elected not to run for re-election in Kentucky. And Rand Paul is doing a money bomb tonight, the 20th of August. And there's a couple hours left to go on his money bomb. And as of an hour or so ago, they had already raised, I think it was over $600,000.
Hmm.
So if you're a libertarian Republican and would like to support the Rand Paul campaign, Google him and go to his website and make a contribution. There's still time. Since the start of this depression, and I call it a depression, not a recession, there have been 6.9 million jobs lost in the private sector. You can't lose $6.9 million and call it a recession. In the meantime, in the public sector, federal, state, and local, $110,000 jobs gained. What is it about the public sector that they think they can skate while the private sector suffers?
Well, the public sector is the productive part of the economy, right?
No.
No, I'm kidding. But no, that's what government can't create wealth. They can do make work jobs, which is essentially what a lot of these are. When you know, how many times did you hear President Obama talking about repairing our crumbling infrastructure, as if maintaining the status quo was somehow going to create wealth within our society? Now they wanted to build a new bridge to somewhere, as long as it's not the one in Alaska, the bridge to nowhere. That actually has the potential to create some wealth by easing transportation costs and such. But
if you take a look at the stimulus bill, very little of it is going into construction. Most of it's going into raises for teachers and other SIEU union workers and other government employees. That's where most of this money is going, to retain jobs or gain jobs for people who are Democratic voting blocs, the public sector unions. That's where the money's going. It's not going to actually do infrastructure building, bridges and roads,
sure,
and so forth.
Sure, looks like it. And there's construction everywhere. It sure feels like there's a lot of construction going on. Maybe that's just me.
Where?
The Bay Area, just everything.
Oh, you're talking about the Highway 50, Highway 80?
All the highways, all the numbers. Yeah. In
Maybe
the
I'm
Bay,
wrong.
It seems like they're all got some people standing there doing nothing. Yeah.
Slowing down traffic.
Slowing down traffic, yeah. With lanes closed.
Well, maybe I'm wrong. Who knows? Yeah. The mayor of Philadelphia, a guy by the name of Michael Nutter, I won't comment on the name, he is threatening to shut down the courts and lay off 1,000 cops and 200 firefighters unless his request for a sales tax increase goes through. Mm. Are we looking at the Washington Monument syndrome here?
No, what we're looking at is protection money. He's shaking down the Philadelphia public with the threat of their house burning down and somebody kicking their door in if they don't pitch in to give him more money to spend on whatever in the heck he feels like spending it for. He's not saying, I'm going to lay off some administrators and some clerks, and I know I can because it takes three of them to do the same work that two or one and a half would do in the private sector. What he's saying is,
And he's not talking about cutting back on street maintenance. He's not talking about cutting back on watering the flowers, on the landscaping services that the city probably does. He's not talking about the less critical services. No. They're talking about cutting into the meat, cutting into the most important services that the government provides.
The only way he could make this shakedown any more obvious was if he said, I'm going to turn off the water supply to your homes unless you vote for this tax increase. It's a shakedown, pure and simple. And we're seeing it in California. We're seeing it here in Sacramento, where they're whacking sheriff's deputies left and right and firing them, and they have so much fat in the system they could trim before those people. Are they doing that? No, they're not doing that. They're laying off deputies so that they can scare people into paying more protection money.
And you can bet they're not firing the vice squad.
Of course not.
They're firing the people who are actually investigating burglaries and robberies and rapes.
You betcha. Yeah, so it's a shakedown, pure and simple. And explain what you meant by Washington Monument syndrome.
The Washington Monument being emblematic of something people actually like to see government doing. In other words, national parks, national monuments. Mm-hmm. The Washington Monument is something that tourists go to Washington to actually see and climb up the thing and climb back down again. I'm not very particularly enamored with the Washington Monument, but I do like Yosemite and I do like Yellowstone. Mm-hmm. The whole idea being that
it's going to be outside.
The first thing that government shuts down in the way of government services are things that people will notice and things that people actually like to see government
doing.
Same
thing here in the state of California. Let's whack state parks. And state parks are, I saw some studies that said they're actual net revenue generators.
Admission fees.
The admission fees and the money spent by tourists when they go external to the park on foods and services and rental cars and airline flights and all the rest of that. They have to get here from somewhere.
Yeah.
So it is a shakedown, pure and simple. And every time government has a problem, they say, we're going to let your house burn down unless you give us some more money. We're going to let criminals kick in your door unless you get us some more money.
I mean, there are places
I'm going to fire my brother-in-law who has his trotters in the trough to the tune of $200,000 a year for a make-work job I gave him. No, it's cops and firefighters.
I know from a source very direct to the situation that in Los Angeles, in the Los Angeles Unified School District, contracts that were let to build new school buildings 5 or 10 years ago, are still going forward. They're doing the site reclamation. They're going into old industrial sites in places like Compton and remediating the soil. Mm-hmm. And what that means is they're doing testing to see if there's any micro sample of anything that's toxic on these sites, and they usually find something because there are, in fact, old industrial sites. Mm-hmm. So they're going to find some, you know, paint fumes or oil fumes,
some mercury,
or whatever.
Some arsenic, some stuff that was
some
standard.
Bad stuff, in some small amounts, but enough to register on their instruments. Mm-hmm. So what they have to do is they have to dig all that dirt out, haul it to a disposal site, probably controlled by an Indian reservation someplace,
where it's incinerated.
I think they just dump it. I don't think you can incinerate.
You're doing a lot
dirt.
Of high temperature incineration.
Maybe
now.
Maybe that too. I don't know. Anyway, they're getting rid of it. They're moving it, and replacing it with concrete slurry or with sand. Mm-hmm. Very, very expensive. All of this is taking place to build a new school for the Los Angeles Unified School District, when the population of school children in Los Angeles is dropping. They don't need the school space anymore.
But is the population of school administrators dropping?
I doubt it very much, because they're also paying school administrators a whole lot of money to oversee this whole mindless procedure.
And what kind of consultants did they bring in to do
very
a
high,
study?
Very, very high paid consultants to do the study and to do the remediation and to do all of the construction and so forth and so on. There's a lot of money being spent by the state of California for school buildings that aren't needed because the students aren't there anymore.
And we've had a net lot. We're losing net population in the state of California, 500 people a day.
I'm not sure what the statistics are, but
People are leaving.
And of course, the sad thing about that is people in California say the taxes are too high here. Regulation is too onerous. Let's move to Nevada, or let's move to Oregon, or let's move to Idaho or Montana. They move there. These are small population states, and when they get there, they take over. And what do? They raise taxes
and
start
taxes
regulating
and
more.
Start regulations.
It's a sad situation.
That's why before you move to Oregon, you have to move to Nevada to get a Nevada plate on your car, so when you move to Oregon, they won't shoot at you. But that's just a little trick I learned.
But you can always run, right? You can run to Switzerland. You can take your money, put it in a Swiss bank, and you'll be safe from the ever grasping hands of the of state and federal taxing authorities. Does that work?
Not anymore. It doesn't. But
wait a minute. What do you mean not anymore? What happened?
Well, UBS, one of the large Swiss banks, has now agreed to, and this is something that the federal government has been working on for a while, they're going to hand over names of U.S. customers to the IRS.
Not all of them.
Not all of them?
No.
Not all of the Swiss banks?
Not all of the names.
There were 50,000, supposedly 50,000 UBS accounts held by Americans in UBS Bank in Switzerland. UBS was allegedly selling tax avoidance schemes to Americans who had opened an account in Switzerland. The IRS didn't think very highly of that, and so they, since UBS does
that,
business and has a huge presence in the United States, I mean, the UBS is a big player in American banking. And so what happened is that the federal government said, you hand over the names of these people that we think maybe might possibly be avoiding taxes, or we're going to shut you down in the United States. And of course, that would break UBS. So UBS initially said, okay, here's the 50,000 names. The government of Switzerland said, no, not so fast. You can't do that. There's bank secrecy in Switzerland, and it's against Swiss law for you to do that. And eventually they sat down and did a diplomatic negotiation between government to government and made a compromise where 4,550 names were released.
About 10%.
I would think that those 4,500 people would have some sort of restitution due them.
Well, it's interesting because those people have the ability to go to court in Switzerland to prevent that from happening, and many of them will. And the other thing that's interesting from a Swiss political standpoint is that if this action by the Swiss government would have gone to a vote in Switzerland probably wouldn't have passed, because the Swiss value
probably
their secrecy. They value their privacy. They value their largest industry. It's interesting. I mean, bank secrecy has been compromised, obviously, but I suspect it hasn't gone away entirely. The Swiss are much too canny for that. Finally, I would like to point out that Mark Lloyd, the Obama administration diversity director, wants government regulation to address the structural imbalance in political talk radio. What is that, John?
Well, according to the socialist poll, 51% of talk radio is conservative. Only 9% is progressive, which is another word for socialism. In 2006, a quote from a book he wrote says that federal and regional funding for public radio should be at or above the level of private radio funding, and that federal and regional funding should be paid for by license fees on privately owned radio stations. This is the lunatic that is the diversity director for the Obama socialist revolution.
So this is the fairness doctrine gussied up and said and trying to be sold as regulatory reform.
It's way more than that. It's license the voices you disagree with and charge them so that you can promote the voices that agree with you because they're government.
I think they need to do this a little bit more efficiently. They need to go down to there's a country down the northern part of South America. I think it's called Venezuela, where Hugo Chavez has made an art form out of silencing his political opposition.
North Korea would be another great example for him.
Yeah, North Korea, that would work. Yeah, there is no political opposition in North Korea. Yeah. But I think Venezuela is a better example for the Obama administration to emulate. By the way, you know, come to think of it, Barack and Hugo were, you know, kind of slapping each other's backs when Barack went to visit Venezuela recently. At least Hugo wasn't saying that he was the devil incarnate, which is what he called George Bush, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
What can I say? They're going to come after us next.
I'm running as fast as I can.
And that'll be the end of things as we know them. That's the show. We'll see you again next week, maybe. Same time, same place, if we're lucky.